Hello, everybody. How are you? Good to see you here. Welcome, welcome. What am I doing? I'm about to start reading and my mind has suddenly gone blank. Go Riki. Okay. Hi. How are you? Good to have you here. Great to see a fellow reader here. What are we up to? We're nearly at the end of Emily of New Moon. She has been and stayed with her weird aunt, great aunt, who lives over in one of the other townships nearby, and successfully actually managed to stay there and enjoy her time there, but also find out an intriguing thing about one of her best, the mother of her best friend. Not actually what happened, but just that there's something terrible that nobody wants to talk about. So I wonder when we're going to find that out. I'm pretty sure it'll be before the end of the book, but we'll see what happens. And she's now back home again to New Moon, and she's enjoying being back in her own home, the place that's been home for her for more than the last year since her father died. She's come to love the place, which is wonderful. And also, she's got her own bedroom now. Instead of being in a shared bedroom with her aunt, the serious aunt that she lives with, she actually is in the same bed as she has, actually has her own bedroom, which used to be her mother's. Her mother, who had run away from home to marry her father. So there's been quite a bit of change in some ways in that time. And also, she's just found out that they have a new teacher at school. So I'm thinking, since the school holidays is finished, she's going to be going back to school, and we will find out a little bit about this new teacher. Hopefully it'll be a teacher who encourages her in her writing endeavors, unlike the previous one, who was really rather biased against her and tended to pick on her. Anyway, so how about we, after I say hi to the new people, how about we get on with actually reading? So if you're new here, hi, I'm Jeff. I read old-fashioned children's books. This book here that we're currently reading, Emily of New Moon, is probably for the oldest age group that I read for. I tend to read for children who are able to understand a story, but it's not particularly detailed. So we've read the Millie Molly Mandy books. They were set for about preschool, early school, the first year or two of school. That was the age group they were targeting, right through to this, which is more early teens, preteen and early teens. By modern standards, this would be a very, very simple lifestyle and a very, very innocent sort of character. But the age group it was originally written for would have been about 12 to 14 year olds. There are two other books in the series, which I won't be reading just because they are that little bit older again. But I do encourage you to read them yourself when you have time to. They're written by L.M. Montgomery. That's Lucy Maud Montgomery, a Canadian author, who is famous for having written the Anne of Green Gables book and its subsequent books. I think there are about 12 of them. And she, after a while, she started to get a little bit frustrated with the publisher and some of the demands they were making of her. And so she stopped writing those and started to write the Emily books, of which she only wrote three. But they're lovely. They also give us a little bit more of an insight into the author's own mind, because you get the feeling when you're reading it that there's aspects of the way she perceives the world, the way she relates to it, how she gets something out of her system when she's been feeling really intensely about it, by writing it down, by making caricatures of the different people involved and so on like that. You get the feeling that this is very much how the author herself first in the early days got into writing. So hopefully we'll get a little bit more carrying on after that. We'll find out what happens. Hopefully it'll be good with the new teacher at school. So the three tips for my new people who are here are: one, make sure you have something to drink. Always have water available, because water is something that your body can take up very, very easily. You can have something else to drink with you as well. I've already finished my orange juice. That's not a problem. But my suggestion for you when you come here to listen to a story is have something to drink. Make sure you have water along with whatever else. Have something to eat This is my throat lozenge, which isn't really an eaty sort of a thing, but that's all I can wave at you at the moment. And have something to sit on, something comfortable. Sorry, yes, I am leaning over. So this is my something to wave at you sample. It's a nice comfortable cushion. I won't be sitting on it because I'm going to be sitting in front of the camera so I can read to you. Yes, yes, definitely. The stream brought to you today by water. Drink some. Fabulous. I love that. I'm going to have to save that bit of that phrase just because I love it. I love that way of putting it. And that's why I'm looking over here on my other monitor, just so I actually can see what I'm doing over there. Right. So, something to drink, something to eat, and somewhere comfortable to sit. Unless, of course, you are studying, you are doing housework where you're moving around, or you're actually at work, working or driving or anything else like that. There will not be a test after we have finished our reading. I am not going to be checking up on you to see if you've paid attention. I am very, very happy to be the little quiet voice in the background for you if you need something to keep your mind busy while you are doing other things. I do have listeners who will often have me talking in the background while they are at work, because the sort of work that they do is the sort of thing where you don't actually have to have all your ears engaged with what you're doing, and they need something to keep their mind busy while their hands are doing their job. So I'm quite happy for that to happen. And if you want to indicate that you are here so I can say hi, just so I know that you're here, rather than just randomly being invisible in the background, you're most welcome to use the lurk command, which will then say something to you to acknowledge that you're here. And it's basically exclamation mark lurk, L-U-R-K, no capitals, no spaces. And it just means that I'm likely to say hi to you at some stage when I actually see it on the chat. I don't tend to chat while I'm reading unless I have asked a question or you're making an observation that's specifically relevant to the story. Then if I manage to catch it in time in the chat box, I will read out the statement or the answer or whatever it is to include that bit of information as it's relevant for the story. Otherwise, I tend to chat between chapters at the beginning and at the end of the stream. So what about we get on with reading? We've done enough talking. Here we go. Emily of New Moon by L.M. Montgomery, and we are reading chapter 28. I got it. The Roman numerals, I got them this time. 28, A Weaver of Dreams. It took Emily several weeks to make up her mind whether she liked Mr. Carpenter or not. That's the new teacher. She knew she did not dislike him, not even though his first greeting, shot at her on the opening day of school in a gruff voice, accompanied by a startling lift of his spiky grey eyebrows, was, "So, you're the girl who writes poetry, eh? Better stick to your needle and duster. Too many fools in the world trying to write poetry and failing. I tried it myself once. Got better sense now." "You don't keep your nails clean," thought Emily. So she's got a way of, 28, XXVIII. 28, that's correct. She's got a way of, when she feels like someone's having a go at her, even if she doesn't say it, she will come up with something that she doesn't like about them just to feel like she's got everything under control, I suppose. I think we all probably do a little bit of that, especially as when we're younger or really feeling that we aren't coping well. Anyway, "You don't keep your nails clean," thought Emily, "but he upset every kind of school tradition so speedily and thoroughly that Ilse, who gloried in upsetting things and hated routine, was the only scholar that liked him from the start." She's a little bit of a rebel. "Some never liked him, the Rhoda Stewart type, for example, but most of them came to it after they got used to never being used to anything. I had a teacher like that. And it was quite a ride. I don't know if you have, but yes, when you have a school teacher who is teaching maths and science, which most of the students at the age of this girl here, who's about 12 years old, just so thoroughly bored with those subjects when you have a teacher that makes them interesting, when he says, right, let's go outside into the playground and make volcanoes, and takes out this chemical powder and pours it out on the seal of the playground behind where the classrooms are, so nobody can see us, so it definitely feels like it's something naughty is about to be happening. Gets the class around in this circle so nobody looking out the window from somewhere else could see us, pours out this pile of powder, and we're talking about it, and he's saying, look, you can see, you know, this is meant to be a mountain. Now let's turn it into a volcano. And so he had a lighter in his pocket, so he lit the very top of this cone, and it has this reaction to heat where it goes from whatever the colour of this powder is, and I can't remember what it is, and it sort of fizzes and makes this fizzing, popping sort of a sound, and it expands a little bit too and changes colour. And so because the top of this volcano shape of powder has been lit, it starts making these noises and spitting bits up, and then it tumbles down the side of this cone shape, and it really does, it looks like a dry powdery volcano erupting. It was quite fun, and this was my first experience of this teacher actually being outside of what was considered to be normal for a teacher. He decided that doing things that you are going to learn from are better if you can have fun while you're doing them, where appropriate. So he did it. He's the one who did it, but we were all watching, and we were most intrigued by it. I have no idea what the chemical was, but it was fun. Yeah, something like baking soda and vinegar, except this is like this pile of powder he poured out of a chemical jar out of the back of the science lab. So it was quite different to what any of us were expecting. Anyway, lots of fun. And it sounds a little bit like Mr. Carpenter was that sort of a teacher as well. Just untypical. Anyway, we'll carry on. So Rhoda Stewart type, for example, never liked him. But most of them came to it after they got used to never being used to anything, and Emily finally decided that she liked him tremendously. Yes, it was good that he played it off as naughty. That does actually catch the imagination of 12 and 13-year-olds, and so you get them on board with you as a teacher. Mr. Carpenter was somewhere between 40 and 50, a tall man with an upstanding shock of bushy grey hair, bristling grey moustache and eyebrows, a truculent beard, bright blue eyes out of which all his wild life had not yet burned the fire, and a long, lean, greyish face deeply lined. He lived in a little two-roomed house below the school with a shy mouse of a wife. He never talked of his past or offered any explanation of the fact that at his age he had no better profession than teaching a district school for a pittance of a salary. But the truth leaked out after a while, for Prince Edward Island is a small province and everybody in it knows something about everybody else. So eventually Blairwater people and even the school children understood that Mr. Carpenter had been a brilliant student in his youth and had had his eye on the ministry. That means becoming a church minister. But at college he had got in with a fast set. Blairwater people nodded their heads slowly and whispered the dreadful phrase portentously, the fast set. And the fast set had ruined him. He took to drink. These are all with quotation marks around them. These are their key phrases for people who don't really behave the way they think they ought to. They're rather religious type of people in this particular part of the island. He took to drink and went to the dogs generally, and the upshot of it all was that Francis Carpenter, who had led his class in his first and second years at McGill, that's the university, very highly prestigious, and for whom his teachers had predicted a great career, was a country school teacher at 45 with no prospect of ever being anything else. Perhaps he was resigned to it, perhaps not. Nobody ever knew, not even the brown mouse of a wife. Nobody in Blairwater cared. He was a good teacher, and that was all that mattered. Even if he did go on occasional sprees, he always took Saturday for them and was sober enough by Monday. Okay. So go Goreiki, sorry, trying to get your name right, says, my high school science teacher taught us force and momentum by sitting on a skateboard and shooting off with a fire extinguisher. Excellent. That's wonderful. I remember when I was doing a dive course, our dive instructor said, whatever you do, don't leave a dive bottle standing up where it can get knocked over, because if the top gets knocked off it, it becomes a flying missile because of the pressured air that's inside it. And all of our imaginations were just exploding with the picture of, you know how you've seen balloons where the cartoons of a balloon where it's blown up, let go, and it zizzes around the place and all that sort of stuff. Well, imagine that with a, like a fire extinguisher, a great big metal cylinder. And he said it actually went through a wall because it had actually happened to one of the people that he had known. I don't know that there were any injuries, but definitely, no, be very careful with your compressed gases in bottles. But that's a great way to show force and momentum is using the skateboard and the fire extinguisher. So thankfully, this new teacher, Mr. Carpenter, even if he does go off and have a bit of a drink in the weekend, is sober by the time it comes round to Monday and teaching, and obviously behaved well enough, even when he was drunk, that he didn't get into trouble for it. He probably kept it under wraps at home or something like that. Sober and especially dignified, wearing a rusty black frock coat, which he never put on any other day of the week. He did not invite pity, and he did not pose as a tragedy, but sometimes when Emily looked at his face, bent over the arithmetic problems of Blairwater School, she felt horribly sorry for him without in the least understanding why. He had an explosive temper which generally burst into flame at least once a day, and then he would storm about wildly for a few minutes, tugging at his beard, imploring heaven to grant him patience, abusing everybody in general and the luckless object of his wrath in particular. But these tempers never lasted long. In a few minutes, Mr. Carpenter would be smiling as graciously as a sun bursting through a storm cloud on the very pupil he had been rating. Nobody seemed to cherish any grudge because of his scoldings, probably because they came and went, and he didn't seem to carry on picking on somebody. It was just letting off steam. He never said any of the biting things Miss Brownell was wont to say, which rankled and festered for weeks. His hail of words fell alike on just and unjust, and rolled off harmlessly. He could take a joke on himself in perfect good nature. Do you hear me? Do you hear me, sirrah? He bellowed to Perry Miller one day. Of course I hear you, reported Perry coolly. They could hear you in Charlottetown, which is the capital. Mr. Carpenter stared for a moment, then broke into a great jolly laugh. His methods of teaching were so different from Miss Brownell's that the Blairwater pupils at first felt as if he had stood them up on their heads. Miss Brownell had been a martinet for order. Absolute, everything had to be done exactly the way she wanted. Nothing out of order. Perfect behaviour. All of that sort of thing. Not the sort of thing that inspires students. Mr. Carpenter never tried to keep order, apparently, but somehow he kept the children so busy that they had no time to do mischief. He taught history tempestuously for a month, making his pupils play the different characters and enact the incidents. He never bothered anyone to learn dates, but the dates stuck in the memory just the same. If, as Mary Queen of Scots, you were beheaded by the school axe, kneeling blindfolded at the doorstep, with Perry Miller wearing a mask made out of a piece of Aunt Laura's old black silk for executioner, Perry Miller for executioner, wondering what would happen if he brought the axe down too hard, you did not forget the year it happened. And if you fought the Battle of Waterloo all over the school playground and heard Teddy Kent shouting, "Up guards and at 'em!" as he led the last furious charge, you remembered 1815 without half trying to. My mother used to teach at a school that had a little bit of difficulty with the sort of students that they had. They'd come from a rather hard background. They had not come from a setting that anyone expected them to do well. And she, not getting them to play act the histories, but she would tell the stories. She would sit there and instead of just reading out dry dates and giving them lists of facts, she would dramatize the story of whatever it was they were studying as part of history. And apparently it made such difference to these students. They actually put in a lot more effort than they otherwise would, and it overflowed into other areas of their learning as well, because she was their teacher for several other subjects, because of the fact that they actually felt a lot more connected with what she was talking about, even though to them initially they were thinking, like, history, it's not going to have anything to do with me. Anyway, so carrying on with the actual story that we're reading here. Next month, history would be thrust aside altogether and geography would take its place, when school and playground were mapped out into countries and you dressed up as the animals inhabiting them or traded in various commodities over their rivers and cities. When Rhoda Stewart had cheated you in a bargain in hides, you remembered that she had bought the cargo from the Argentine Republic. And when Perry Miller would not drink any water for a whole summer day because he was crossing the Arabian desert with a caravan of camels and could not find an oasis, and then drank so much that he took terrible cramps and Aunt Laura had to be up all night with him, you did not forget where the said desert was. The trustees were quite scandalised over some of the goings-on. That's the board of trustees for the school, the governors for the school. Were quite scandalised over some of the goings-on and felt sure that the children were having too good of a time to be really learning anything. If you wanted to learn Latin and French, you had to do it by taking your exercises, not writing them, and on Friday afternoons all lessons were put aside and Mr. Carpenter made the children recite poems, made speeches, make speeches, and declaim passages from Shakespeare and the Bible. This was the day Ilse loved. Mr. Carpenter pounced on her gift like a starving dog on a bone and drilled her without mercy. They had endless fights, and Ilse stamped her foot and called him names while the other pupils wondered why she was not punished for it, but at least had to give in. At last had to give in and do as he willed. Oh, yeah, because Ilse wants to be do recitations. I can't remember. They've already given us in one of the other chapters the name of what it is that she wants to do. And it's got a special name, but I can't remember it. So therefore, she's thriving on this, but also he's challenging her to be better than what she already is. But she at last had to give in and do as he willed. Ilse went to school regularly, something she had never done before. Mr. Carpenter had told her that if she were absent for a day without a good excuse, she could take no part in the Friday exercises, and this would have killed her. One day, Mr. Carpenter had picked up Teddy's slate and found a sketch of himself on it in one of his favourite, if not exactly beautiful, attitudes. That's a stance or a position that he was standing in. Attitudes were something that if you've ever listened to or read or watched a fairly authentic rendering of Pride and Prejudice, I think, the younger sisters at one stage are practicing their attitudes, and it was where you would hold a pose that was reminiscent of a particular character in a particular story, and they had names for all of these. And so the overflow of that is to referring to this, not in one of his favourite, if not exactly beautiful, attitudes. It's one of these stances, one of these standing or moving positions that he regularly would use. Teddy had labelled it the Black Death. Half of the pupils in the school having died that day of the Great Plague and having been carried out on stretchers to the Potter's Field by the terrified survivors. Teddy expected a roar of denunciation, for the day before, Garrett Marshall had been ground into figurative pulp on being discovered with the picture of a harmless cow on his slate. At least, Garrett said he meant it for a cow, but now this amazing Mr. Carpenter only drew his beetling brows together, looked earnestly at Teddy's slate, put it down on the desk, looked at Teddy and said, "I don't know anything about drawing. I can't help you, but by gad, I think hereafter you'd better give up those extra arithmetic problems in the afternoon and draw pictures." Whereupon Garrett Marshall went home and told his father that old Carpenter wasn't fair and made favourites over Teddy Kent. Mr. Carpenter went up to the Tansy Patch that evening and saw the sketches in Teddy's old barn loft studio. Then he went into the house and talked to Mrs. Kent. What he said and what she said, nobody ever knew. But Mr. Carpenter went away looking grim, as if he had met an unexpected match. He took great pains with Teddy's general schoolwork after that, and procured from somewhere certain elementary textbooks on drawing which he gave to him, telling him not to take them home. A caution Teddy did not require. He knew quite well that if he did, they would disappear as mysteriously as had his cats. He had taken Emily's advice and told his mother he would not love her if anything happened to Leo, that's his puppy, and Leo flourished and waxed fat and doggy. But Teddy was too gentle at heart and too fond of his mother to make such a threat more than once. He knew she had cried all that night after Mr. Carpenter had been there, and prayed on her knees in her little bedroom most of the next day, and looked at him with bitter, haunting eyes for a week. He wished she were more like other fellows' mothers, but they loved each other very much and had dear hours together in the little grey house on the Tansy Hill. It was only when other people were about that Mrs. Kent was queer and jealous. "She's always lovely when we're alone," Teddy had told Emily. As for the other boys, Perry Miller was the only one Mr. Carpenter bothered much with in the way of speeches, and he was as merciless with him as he was with Ilse. Perry worked hard to please him and practised his speeches in barn and field, and even by nights in the kitchen loft. So Perry comes from a rather poor part of town. His family background is very poor. So the adults tend to look down on him because he comes from the wrong side of the tracks. And he works up at the property where Emily lives at New Moon. He assists Emily's uncle Jimmy, and as a general dog's body and other bits and pieces like that. Gives him some skills, it gives him a little bit of pay, and it gives him, he's well fed and accommodated compared with him being at home. It probably takes off a little bit of pressure at home too. Where do we get to? And even by nights in the kitchen loft he was practicing, until Aunt Elizabeth put a stop to that. Emily could not understand why Mr. Carpenter would smile amiably and say very good when Nettie Gray rattled off a speech glibly, without any expression whatever, and then rage at Perry and denounce him as a dunce and a nincompoop, by gad, because he had failed to give just the proper emphasis on a certain word, or had timed his gesture a fraction of a second too soon. Neither could she understand why he made red pencil corrections all over her compositions and rated her for split infinitives and too lavish adjectives, and strode up and down the aisle and hurled objurgations at her because she didn't know a good place to stop when she saw it, by gad, and then told Rhoda Stewart and Nan Lee that their compositions were very pretty and gave them back without so much as a mark on them. Yet, in spite of it all, she liked him more and more as time went on, and autumn passed, and winter came with its beautiful bare-limbed trees and soft pearl-grey skies that were slashed with rifts of gold in the afternoons and cleared to a jewelled pageantry of stars over the wide white hills and valleys around New Moon. Emily shot up so that winter... Aunt Laura had to let down the tucks in her dresses. Aunt Ruth, who had come for a week's visit, said she was outgrowing her strength. Consumptive children always did. Aunt Ruth has very strong opinions and does not like Emily because Emily has her own mind. "I am not consumptive," Emily said, because her father and I think her mother had both died of tuberculosis, which is consumption. "The stars are tall," she added with a touch of subtle malice, hardly to be looked for in the near 13. So obviously Aunt Ruth is not tall. The stars, her family surname, S-T-A-R-R, excuse me. The stars are tall, she added with a touch of subtle malice, hardly to be looked for in near 13. Aunt Ruth, who was sensitive in regard to her dumpiness, sniffed. It would be well if that were the only thing in which you resemble them, she said. How are you getting on in school? Very well. I'm the smartest scholar in my class, answered Emily composedly. You conceited child, said Aunt Ruth. I'm not conceited, Emily looked scornful indignation. Mr. Carpenter said it, and he doesn't flatter. Besides, I can't help seeing it myself. Well, it is to be hoped you have some brains, because you haven't much in the way of looks, said Aunt Ruth. You've no complexion to speak of, and that inky hair around your white face is startling. I see you're going to be a plain girl. You wouldn't say that to a grown-up person's face, said Emily with deliberate gravity, which always exasperated Aunt Ruth because she could not understand it in a child. I don't think it would hurt you to be as polite to me as you are to other people, said Emily. I am telling you your faults so you may correct them, said Aunt Ruth frigidly. It isn't my fault that my face is pale and my hair black, protested Emily. I can't correct that. If you were a different girl, said Aunt Ruth, I would... But I don't want to be a different girl, said Emily decidedly. She had no intention of lowering the star flag to Aunt Ruth, because Aunt Ruth is a Murray. I wouldn't want to be anybody but myself, even if I am plain. Besides, she added impressively as she turned to go out of the room, though I may not be very good looking now, when I go to heaven I believe I'll be very beautiful. Some people think Emily quite pretty, said Aunt Laura, but she did not say it until Emily was out of hearing. She was Murray enough for that. Doesn't want her getting a little bit too vain. I don't know where they see it, said Aunt Ruth. She's vain and pert and says things to be thought smart. You heard her just now, but the thing I dislike most in her is that she is unchildlike and deep as the sea. Yes, she is, Laura, deep as the sea. You'll find out to your cost one day if you disregard my warning. She's capable of anything. Sly is no word for it. You and Elizabeth don't keep a tight enough rein over her. I've done my best, said Aunt Elizabeth stiffly. She herself did think she had been much too lenient with Emily. Laura and Jimmy were 2-1, but it nettled her to have Ruth say so. So, I'm not sure, but I think they may be sisters, either sisters or cousins, I'm not sure. Uncle Wallace also had an attack of worrying over Emily that winter. It's another one who's a bit of a pain in her family. Most of them are. He looked at her one day when he was at New Moon and remarked that she was getting to be a big girl. How old are you, Emily? He asked her that every time he came to New Moon. 13 in May. What are you going to do with her, Elizabeth? I don't know what you mean, said Aunt Elizabeth coldly, or as coldly as is possible to speak when one is pouring melted tallow into candle moulds. Why, she'll soon be grown up. She can't expect you to provide for her indefinitely. I don't, Emily whispered resentfully under her breath. And it's time we decided what is best to be done for her. The Murray women have never had to work out. The Murray women have never had to work out for a living, said Aunt Elizabeth, as if that disposed of the matter. Emily is only half Murray, said Wallace. Besides, times are changing. You and Laura will not live forever, Elizabeth. And when you are gone, New Moon goes to Oliver's nephew. In my opinion, Emily should be fitted to support herself if necessary. Emily did not like Uncle Wallace, but she was very grateful to him at that moment. Whatever his motives were, he was proposing the very thing she secretly yearned for. I would suggest, said Uncle Wallace, that she be sent to Queen's Academy to get a teacher's license. Teaching is a genteel, ladylike occupation. I will do my share in providing for the expense of it. A blind person might have seen that Uncle Wallace thought this very splendid of himself. If you do, thought Emily, I'll pay every cent back as soon as I'm able to earn it. She doesn't want to be beholden to Uncle Wallace. But Aunt Elizabeth was adamant. "I do not believe in girls going out into the world," she said. "I don't mean Emily to go to Queen's." Very, very, very prestigious in later days, I don't know about at the time, university on Prince Edward Island. And it's now been incorporated, it's still there, but it's been incorporated into the, whatever they call the university on Prince Edward Island now, which I'm going to look up. I haven't done one of these diversions today. So it's time. Let's have a look. I'm looking at Google Maps, in case you're wondering. Prince Edward Island, there it is. University is Charlotte. It's in Charlottetown. University of Prince Edward Island. There you go. That makes a lot of sense. And it's in Charlottetown, which is the capital of Prince Edward Island. I'm not sure whereabouts along the north coast that the book is set, but it is definitely set on Prince Edward Island. I'm just going to see if... There you go. There's the island itself. This is Nova Scotia down here, and this is New Brunswick here, and that is the Newfoundland. The Labrador is up there. Newfoundland is... Newfoundland. Newfoundland is... a great big huge lump of land, and then you've got Prince Edward Island, which looks on there to be quite big, but compared with this over here is not, mind you, that's completely different geography wise as well. Right, let's carry on. Queen's College is now part of Prince Edward Island University. And they're quite proud of it. It's wonderful, actually, to know that places like that that are included in a story are real, and they still exist, even if it's included in something that's bigger. I do not believe in girls going out into the world, she said. I don't mean Emily to go to Queen's. I told Mr. Carpenter so when he came to see me about her taking up the entrance work. He was very rude. School teachers knew their place better in my father's time, but I made him understand, I think. I'm rather surprised at you, Wallace. You did not send your own daughter out to work. My daughter had parents to provide for her, said Uncle Wallace pompously. Emily is an orphan. I imagined from what I had heard about her that she would prefer earning her own living to living on charity. So I would, cried out Emily. So I would, Uncle Wallace. Oh, Aunt Elizabeth, please let me study for the entrance. Please, I'll pay you back every cent you spend on it. I will indeed. I pledge you my word of honour. It does not happen to be a question of money, said Aunt Elizabeth in her stateliest manner. I undertook to provide for you, Emily. And I will do it. When you are older, I may send you to the high school in Shrewsbury for a couple of years. I am not decrying education. But you are not going to be a slave to the public. No Murray girl ever was that. Emily, realizing the uselessness of pleading, went out in the same bitter disappointment she had felt after Mr. Carpenter's visit. Then Aunt Elizabeth looked at Wallace. Have you forgotten what came of sending Juliet to Queen's? She asked significantly. Juliet is Emily's mother, who ran away from home to marry Emily's father, had Emily, and then died. If Emily was not allowed to take up the entrance classes, Perry had no one to say him nay, and he went at them with the same dogged determination he showed on all other matters. Perry's status at New Moon had changed subtly and steadily. Aunt Elizabeth had ceased to refer scornfully to him as a hired boy. Even she recognised that though he was still indubitably a hired boy, he was not going to remain one, and she no longer objected to Laura's patching up his ragged bits of clothing, or to Emily's helping him with his lessons in the kitchen after supper. Nor did she growl when Cousin Jimmy began to pay him a certain small wage. So up until then, he got free board and lodging for helping around the farm, which was a better option than staying back in the shack with his grandmother, I think it was, over in Tin Pipe Town, Tin Stove Town, something like that, which was the local nickname for a rather rough area that he grew, that he had been living in. But now I need to find out where I got to. I forgot to explain that to you, that I often get lost halfway through a sentence, sometimes when I'm actually reading it. Cousin Jimmy began to pay him a certain small wage, although older boys than Perry were still glad to put it... I will start the beginning of the sentence again. Aunt Elizabeth no longer objected to Laura's patching up his ragged bits of clothing, or to Emily's helping him with his lessons in the kitchen after supper, nor did she growl when Cousin Jimmy began to pay him a certain small wage, though older boys than Perry were still glad to be put in the winter months choring for board and lodging in some comfortable home. So he's happy to be being paid, obviously, but also on top of that, there are other boys who are older than him who quite happily will do what he used to do, which was having his board and lodging covering the cost of the work that he was doing. So it's really is a bonus. If a future premier was in the making at New Moon, premier is like Prime Minister of New Zealand or President of the States, premier in Canada, the head of the country. If a future premier was in the making at New Moon, Aunt Elizabeth wanted to have some small share in the making. It was credible and commendable that a boy should have ambitions. A girl was an entirely different matter. A girl's place was at home, thought Aunt Elizabeth. Emily helped Perry work out algebra problems and heard his lessons in French and Latin. She picked up more thus than Aunt Elizabeth would have approved, and more still when the entrance pupils talked those languages in school. It was quite an easy matter for a girl who had once upon a time invented a language of her own. When George Bates, by way of showing off, asked her one day in French, his French, of which Mr. Carpenter had once said doubtfully that perhaps God might understand it, "Have you the ink of my grandmother and the shoe brush of my cousin and the umbrella of my aunt's husband in your desk?" was what he had said. Emily retorted quite as glibly and quite as Frenchily, "No, but I have the pen of your father and the cheese of the innkeeper and the towel of your uncle's maidservant in my basket," in French. To console herself in her disappointment in regard to the entrance class, Emily wrote more poetry than ever. It was especially delightful to write poetry on a winter's evening when the storm winds howled without and heaped the garden and orchard with big ghostly drifts starred over with rabbit's candles. I think there are rabbit's candles. Oh, they might be a little bit like the plant that we have that we call bunny tails. Rabbit's candles. Let's see. Plant. Because I'm getting pictures of candles that are made in the shape of rabbits. And yes, my keyboard is really loud. Rabbit's candles. No. That one has got me intrigued. I really need to look that one up, because I'm going to look up the one that I know. And I'm wondering if it's the same sort of thing. We call it bunny tails. Apparently it's also called hare's tails. And I'm just going to put it into the right folder here so I can put it into where you can see it. And yes, I know I don't really need to be doing this, but I just think it makes it a little bit more interesting. Just got to find the right folder to put it in. Nearly there. Right, let's see if I can find it here for you now. Show it up in, oops, that's going to be too small. That's going to be a bit better. This is the one that to me is, we call it rabbit's tails, and I'm wondering if this is the one that she calls rabbit's candles. We call it bunny tails. We'll find out, but I'm not going to be finding that out while I'm actually still reading, okay? Although if you want to, you can look it up. And then you can give me a hint as to where to find the right description of it. If you think that you can, that's cool. You can let me know. rabbit's candles. Rabbit, R-A-B-B-I-T, and then candles that you'd use for lighting. And I think it's a plant that has its flower heads or its seed heads or something sticking up above the snow, because she's talking about it being snowy outside. Yes, thank you for looking that up. We'll carry on with the find out where I was on the page again. Pampas grass. Oh, okay. It's a lot bigger. So it's a lot bigger than this one. I know what pampas grass looks like. We've got a native plant that is very similar that we call toi toi, T-O-I-T-O-I. I'll find that one for you. Not quite sure why I wasn't finding it and you were. And I'm just going to put this picture up here just for those who need to have a picture of pampas grass. Save image. Here we go. That's probably why, yeah. Weren't using the possessive. Very good. That's that one, and I shall put that up there behind me and resize the picture so you can see it better. So that's pampas grass from the pampas in South America, I would guess. It may be common there, I don't know which is named after which. Anyway, so there you go. That's what she calls rabbit candles or rabbit's candles. Trying to find out where I got to on the page. Right, to console herself for her disappointment in regard to the entrance class. Oh, and thank you for finding out what they were called for me. Thank you. Oh, rabbit tail flower. Very good. Yeah, that's a good way to put it. And you can see how the one that I put up has a similar look, except that they are this big as this, next to my head, the little fluffy bit. Whereas pampas grass, this thing here, the flower heads are like bigger than my head. Anyway, I'll carry on reading. To console herself for her disappointment in regard to the entrance class, Emily wrote more poetry than ever. It was especially delightful to write poetry on a winter evening when the storm winds howled without and heaped the garden and orchards with big ghostly drifts, starred over with rabbit's candles. Yes, I can imagine that the flowers of the pampas grass would actually stand well above it. She also wrote several stories, desperate love affairs, wherein she struggled heroically against the difficulties of affectionate dialogue. Yes, she's used to writing poetry, not emotional, romantic stuff, because she hasn't had these life experiences yet. Struggled heroically against the difficulties of affectionate dialogue. Tales of bandits and pirates. Emily liked these because there was no necessity for bandits and pirates to converse lovingly. Tragedies of earls and countesses, whose conversation she dearly loved to pepper with scraps of French. And a dozen other subjects she didn't know anything about. She also meditated beginning a novel, but decided it would be too hard to get enough paper for it. The letter bills were all done now, and the Jimmy books were not big enough, though a new one always appeared mysteriously in her school basket when the old one was almost full. Cousin Jimmy seemed to have an uncanny prescience of the proper time. That was part of his Jimminess. Then one night, as she lay in her lookout bed and watched a full moon gleaming lustrously from a cloudless sky across the valley, she had a sudden, dazzling idea. She would send her latest poem to the Charlottetown Enterprise. I'm guessing that that is the local paper. Ooh, the island paper, a bit like the New Zealand Herald is for the upper half of the North Island of New Zealand. It's not actually for all of New Zealand. It is a regional newspaper. We don't really have any national newspapers. But they all run a similar purpose. Anyway, so the Charlottetown Enterprise. The Enterprise had a poet's corner where original verses were frequently printed. Privately, Emily thought her own were quite as good, as probably they were, for most of the Enterprise poems were sad trash. Emily was so excited over the idea that she could not sleep for the greater part of the night and didn't want to. It was glorious to lie there, thrilling in the darkness, and picture the whole thing out. She saw her verses in print signed E. Burt Starr. She saw Aunt Laura's eyes shining with pride. She saw Mr. Carpenter pointing them out to strangers. "The work of a pupil of mine, by gad," she's imagining. She saw all her schoolmates envying her or admiring, according to type. She saw herself with one foot at least firmly planted on the ladder of fame, one hill at least of the alpine path crested, with a new and glorious prospect opening therefrom. Morning came. Emily went to school so absent-minded because of her secret that she did badly in everything and was raged at by Mr. Carpenter, but it all slipped off her like the proverbial water off a duck's back. Her body was in Blairwater School, but her spirit was in Kingdoms Imperial. Imperial? E-M-P-Y-R-E-A-L. I don't know, something to do with poetry. Obviously, I'm not a poet. I don't write poetry. As soon as school was out, she betook herself to the garret with half a sheet of blue-lined notepaper. Very painstakingly, she copied down the poem, being especially careful to dot every I and cross every T. She wrote it on both sides of the paper, being in blissful ignorance of any taboo thereon. When you're writing for publication, you write one side of the page. Then she read it aloud, delightedly, not omitting the title, Evening Dreams. There was one line in it she tasted two or three times. The haunting elfin music of the air. "I think that line is very good," said Emily. "I wonder now how I happened to think of it." She mailed her poem the next day and lived in a delicious mystic rapture until the following Saturday. When the Enterprise came, she opened it with tremulous eagerness and ice-cold fingers and turned to the poet's corner. Now for her great moment! There was not a sign of an evening dream about it. Emily threw down the Enterprise and fled to the garret dormer where, face downward on the old haircloth sofa, she wept out her bitterness of disappointment. She drained the draught of failure to the very dregs. It was horribly real and tragic to her. She felt exactly as if she had been slapped in the face. She was crushed in the very dust of humiliation and was sure she could never rise again. How thankful she was that she hadn't told Teddy anything about it. She had been so strongly tempted to and only refrained because she didn't want to spoil the dramatic surprise of the moment when she would show him the verses with her name signed to them. She had told Perry. Perry was furious when he saw her tear-stained face later on in the dairy as they strained the milk together. Ordinarily, Emily loved this, but tonight, that's working in the dairy with him, but tonight the savour had gone out of the world. even the milky splendour of the still, mild winter evening, and the purple bloom over the hillside woods that presaged a thaw, could not give her the accustomed soul thrill. "I'm going to Charlottetown if I have to walk there, and I'll bust that Enterprise editor's head," said Perry, with the expression which, 30 years later, warned the members of his party to scatter for cover. That means he actually did make it into politics, because that's the members of his party, that's his political party. "That wouldn't be any use," said Emily drearily. "He didn't think it good enough to print. That is what hurts me so, Perry. He didn't think it any good. Busting his head wouldn't change that." Now, imperial, or of or relating to the heavens or firmament. Celestial. Thank you. Very good. Very useful to know. Not a word I think I will probably remember well enough to use it, but intriguing nonetheless. It took her a week to recover from the blow. Then she wrote a story in which the editor of the Enterprise played the part of a dark and desperate villain who found lodging eventually behind prison bars. I told you she worked out her feelings through her writing. This got the venom out of her system, and she forgot all about him in the delight of writing a poem addressed to Sweet Lady April. But I question if she ever really forgave him, even when she discovered eventually that you must not write on both sides of the paper, even when she read over Evening Dreams a year later and wondered how she could ever have thought it any good. This sort of thing was happening frequently now. Every time she read her little hoard of manuscripts over, she found some of which the fairy gold had unaccountably turned to withered leaves. Fit only for the burning, Emily burned them, but it hurt her a little. Outgrowing things we love is never a pleasant process. And that's the end of that chapter, and I am going to read the next one. It's just about 4 o'clock, but I think we'll read the next one anyway. So time for a chapter break. Get yourself something to drink. Yes, this channel runs on water. Go and get yourself some water if you don't already have it. Get yourself something to drink and something to eat. Get comfortable again. We're ready. We'll be going again in a minute. And if you need to go to the loo, quick, hurry off. Oh, and just by the by, if you don't mind me saying, what time zone are you in? I'm just intrigued by it because I have friends that live in Canada and England, all over the world. And it's, I read at a time that works for me. It's the middle of my afternoon here in New Zealand, mid to late afternoon. But I realise it's not necessarily a great time for other people in other countries, such as the States. I'm tempted to get a mock-up of a pet's water bottle, like in a gerbil or a rabbit cage. Yeah, exactly. I ended up getting myself a drinking jar, like a cup, but with a lid, so it's not going to spill as easily, with a straw to it, just because before that I used to be tipping this water bottle up all the time, and you ended up seeing, because as it gets closer to the camera, it gets huge, and it was just a little bit disconcerting having this great big thing slopping around like this all the time. But yeah, having a water bottle that you can just sort of sip on, that's held in place for you, and you can just relax and drink your water whenever you want, it's a good idea. You're in Japan, it's almost 1 p.m. I did wonder about that. So hopefully it's not too difficult in terms of the day of the week and what you would otherwise be doing. It's great to have you here too. Love it. I'm trying to keep track of what else I'm meant to do. There are certain things I'm meant to do, I think. I do have a couple of moderators, but because it's usually very, very quiet here, which this is good. One of them is watching another friend's stream, and the other one, I think, is finishing off work for the evening and doing dinner, probably, just because she's in Canada and it's the wrong time of day for her. Other hemisphere, so she's on, I think she's gone into her summertime and we're now in our wintertime in terms of clock, daylight savings. And I've hardly seen any bots, so you've obviously paid attention to my security. Yes, definitely. there are some aspects of setting up filters that I had already been working on, but it's one of those you keep tweaking things as you can, and you keep an eye out. And one of the things I try to do when I first get going, because I start my stream about 10 minutes before 3 o'clock, and it means that it has enough time for the notifications to go out to my other social media locations, so that people can actually arrive and not have to sit through an advert when I'm already reading, so they feel like they're missing it. But it means that if the bots come in, they've had 10 minutes of being able to settle in, and I can have a look at who they are, what they are auto-hosting, because the fact that there are certain auto-hosting channels that usually indicate that you're dealing with a bot, and so I can ban them before we get started, and I'm not having to fluff around with that once we're actually going on the story. I've got my throat lozenge in because my throat's a little bit dry. I've got the start of a cold at the moment, and I had a bit of a sinus headache earlier on, but the actual talking, the vibration from it is actually helping my head a little bit, so that's good. I really appreciated your talk, your discussion of things that you could do, to wise things to do about preventing bots being a problem. So that was much appreciated. Right, and I think I'm ready. Sorry, just get my chair in the right place so it's not going to scoot backwards, and I'm comfortable enough for the second half of our session. I think I need to take this out of my mouth now. I'm looking for something. Excuse me. Right. A bit hard to read when you've got something bouncing around in your mouth at the same time. Right, here we go. Emily of New Moon by L.M. Montgomery, and we are reading chapter 29, Sacrilege. Ooh, that's interesting. We'll see what that means. Here we go. And I'm not sure, but this might be the second to last chapter. No, there's two more chapters after this, so this is good that we're actually reading this one now. Because I like to read either one or two chapters when they're as long as this one is, as this author tends to write. So here we go, chapter 29, Sacrilege. There had been several clashes between Aunt Elizabeth and Emily that winter and spring. Generally, Aunt Elizabeth came out victorious. There was that in her that would not be denied the satisfaction of having her own way, even in trifling matters. But once in a while, she came up against that curious streak of granite in Emily's composition, which was unyielding and unbendable and unbreakable. Mary Murray of 100 years agone had been, so Family Chronicle ran, a gentle and submissive creature generally, but she had that same streak in her as her "Here I Stay" abundantly testified. She had been the one who had, on the trip out to Canada from Ireland or Scotland, it had been a horrendous trip. She had got badly... Excuse me. I'm just going to mute the microphone for that came from nowhere. Right. She had got badly seasick. They had stopped off to top up their water supplies and things like this in the sailing ship that was coming out to Canada. And they hadn't yet arrived at where they were meant to be going to. She had gone ashore, and the thinking had been that those who had been feeling unwell, because it had been such a horrendous trip, would be able to relax, start to feel a bit better, and then they could get back on board the ship and carry on to where they were meant to be going. And I'm guessing it's somewhere further up the St. Lawrence River, because you can get a long way into Canada by going up the river. And she had put her foot down and said, "Here I stay. I am not going any further," which is why the family had settled in on Prince Edward Island in Canada. Right, so here we go. She had that same streak in her as her "Here I Stay" abundantly testified. When Aunt Elizabeth tried conclusions with that element in Emily, she always got the worst of it. Yet she did not learn wisdom therefrom, but pursued her policy of repression all the more rigorously, for it occasionally came home to her, as Laura let down tucks, that Emily was on the verge of beginning to grow up, and that various breakers and reefs loomed ahead, ominously magnified in the mist of unseen years. Now, both Emily, Elizabeth and Laura, as far as I can understand, don't actually have children. And so this is, I think, a little bit scary for Aunt Elizabeth, elderly woman, having to bring up a teenage girl, or this is ahead of her. Not that they would have called them teenagers back then, but something quite scary, and something where she's, because of Emily's mother's history and the difficulties it was caused for the family, she's wanting to make sure that Emily grows up in a way that is appropriate and doesn't go off the rails. I think that's a lot of the motivation behind it. Emily was on the verge of beginning to grow up, and the various breakers and reefs loomed ahead, ominously magnified in the mist of unseen years. Emily must not be allowed to get out of hand now, lest later on she make shipwreck as her mother had done, or as Elizabeth Murray firmly believed she had done. There were, in short, to be no more elopements from New Moon. One of the things they fell out about was the fact that Emily, as Aunt Elizabeth discovered one day, was in the habit of using more of her egg money to buy paper than Aunt Elizabeth approved of. What did Emily do with so much paper? They had a fuss over this, and eventually Aunt Elizabeth discovered that Emily was writing stories. Emily had been writing stories all winter under Aunt Elizabeth's very nose, and Aunt Elizabeth had never suspected it. She had fondly supposed that Emily was writing school compositions. Aunt Elizabeth knew in a vague way that Emily wrote silly rhymes, which she called poetry, but this did not worry her especially. Jimmy made up a lot of similar trash. It was foolish but harmless, and Emily would doubtless outgrow it. Jimmy had not outgrown it, to be sure, but then his accident, Elizabeth always went a little sick in soul when she remembered it, had made him more or less a child for life. She was the one who caused it, actually. It's probably why she's trying to keep such tight control over things. But writing stories was a very different thing, and Aunt Elizabeth was horrified. Fiction of any kind was an abominable thing. Elizabeth Murray had been trained up in this belief in her youth, and in her age she had not departed from it. She honestly thought that it was a wicked and sinful thing in anyone to play cards, dance, or go to the theatre, read, or write novels. And in Emily's case, there was a worse feature. It was the star coming out in her. Douglas Star, especially. That's Emily's father, who Emily's mother had eloped with. No Murray of New Moon had ever been guilty of writing stories, or of ever wanting to write them. It was an alien growth that must be pruned off ruthlessly. Aunt Elizabeth applied the pruning shears and found no pliant, snippable root, but that same underlying streak of granite. Emily was respectful and reasonable and above board. She bought no more paper with egg money, but she told Aunt Elizabeth that she could not give up writing stories, and she went right on writing them on pieces of brown wrapping paper and the blank backs of circulars which agricultural machinery firms sent to Cousin Jimmy. "Don't you know that it is wicked to write novels?" demanded Aunt Elizabeth. "Oh, I'm not writing novels yet," said Emily. "I can't get enough paper. These are just short stories, and it isn't wicked. Father liked novels." "Your father," began Aunt Elizabeth, and stopped. She remembered that Emily had acted up before now when anything derogatory was said of her father, but the very fact that she felt mysteriously compelled to stop annoyed Elizabeth, who had said what seemed good to her all her life at New Moon without much regard for other people's feelings. "You will not write any more of this stuff," Aunt Elizabeth contemptuously flourished. "The secret of the castle," contemptuously flourished "The Secret of the Castle" under Emily's nose. Obviously, that was the title of the latest one she's written. "I forbid you. Remember, I forbid you." "Oh, I must write, Aunt Elizabeth," said Emily gravely, folding her slender, beautiful hands on the table and looking straight into Aunt Elizabeth's angry face with the steady, unblinking gaze which Aunt Ruth called unchildlike. "You see, it is this way. It is in me. I can't help it. And Father said I was always to keep on writing. He said I would be famous someday. Wouldn't you like to have a famous niece, Aunt Elizabeth?" "I am not going to argue the matter," said Aunt Elizabeth. "I'm not arguing, only explaining." Emily was exasperatingly respectful. "I just want you to understand how it is that I have to go on writing stories, even though I am so very sorry you don't approve." "If you don't give up this worse than nonsense, Emily, I'll... Aunt Elizabeth stopped, not knowing what to say she would do. Emily was too big now to be slapped or shut up, and it was no, that means shut up, locking her own in a room, which she has done before, and it was no use to say, as she was tempted to, "I'll send you away from New Moon," because Elizabeth Murray knew perfectly well she would not send Emily away from New Moon, could not send her away. Indeed, though this knowledge was as yet only in her feelings and had not been translated into her intellect, she only felt that she was helpless and that it angered her. But Emily was mistress of the situation and calmly went on writing stories. If Aunt Elizabeth had asked her to give up crocheting lace or making molasses taffy or eating Aunt Laura's delicious drop cookies, Emily would have done so wholly and cheerfully, though she loved these things. But to give up writing stories, why, Aunt Elizabeth might as well have asked her to give up breathing. Why couldn't she understand? It seemed so simple and indisputable to Emily. "Teddy can't help making pictures, and Ilse can't help reciting, and I can't help writing. Don't you see, Aunt Elizabeth?" "I see that you are an ungrateful and disobedient child," said Aunt Elizabeth. This hurt Emily horribly, but she could not give in, and there continued to be a sense of soreness and disapproval between her and Aunt Elizabeth in all the little details of daily life that poisoned existence more or less for the child, who was so keenly sensitive to her environment and to the feelings with which her kindred regarded her. Emily felt it all the time, except when she was writing her stories. Then she forgot everything, roaming in some enchanted country between the sun and moon, where she saw wonderful beings whom she tried to describe, and wonderful deeds which she tried to record, coming back to the candlelit kitchen with a somewhat dazed sense of having been years in no man's land. She did not even have Aunt Laura to back her up in the matter. Aunt Laura thought Emily ought to yield in such an unimportant matter and please Aunt Elizabeth. Poor Aunt Laura, I don't think she quite gets it yet. "But it's not unimportant," said Emily despairingly. "It is the most important thing in the world to me, Aunt Laura. Oh, I thought you would understand." "I understand that you like to do it, dear, and I think it is harmless enough amusement, but it seems to annoy Elizabeth some way, and I do think you might give it up on that account. It is not as if it was anything that mattered much. It is really a waste of time." "No, no," said the distressed Emily. "Why, someday, Aunt Laura, I'll write real books and make lots of money," she added, sensing that the businesslike Murrays measured the nature of most things on a cash basis. Aunt Laura smiled indulgently. "I'm afraid you'll never grow rich that way, dear. It would be wiser to employ your time preparing yourself for some useful work. It was maddening to be considered to, condescended to like this, maddening that nobody could see that she had to write, maddening to have Aunt Laura so sweet and loving and stupid about it. Oh, thought Emily bitterly, what if that hateful Enterprise editor had printed my piece, they'd have believed then? At any rate, advised Aunt Laura, don't let Elizabeth see you writing them. But somehow Emily could not take this prudent advice. There had been occasions when she had connived with Aunt Laura to hoodwink Aunt Elizabeth on some little matter, but she found she could not do it in this. This had to be open and above board. She must write stories, and Aunt Elizabeth must know it. That was the way it had to be. She could not be false to herself in this. She could not pretend to be false. She wrote her father all about it. So, if you're new here, Emily, we haven't had any recently in the story, but Emily writes every night, or nearly every night, a letter to her father. Her father has died some time ago, probably near a year and a half ago, maybe coming up to 2 years. And it's her way of getting the day's events and everything else that's happening, processing them and getting them out of her system, but also helping her to share them so she doesn't feel like they're so overwhelming. And it gives her a sense of still being in touch with her father, even though he's dead. It made the loss that she felt at his dying a lot more bearable when she felt that she could share her daily life with him still. She wrote to her father all about it, poured out her bitterness and perplexity to him in what she thought, in what, though she did not suspect it at the time, was the last letter she was to write to him. There was a large bundle of letters by now on the old sofa shelf in the garret, for Emily had written many letters to her father, besides those which have been chronicled in this history. There were a great many paragraphs about Aunt Elizabeth in them, most of them very uncomplimentary, and some of them, as Emily herself would have owned when her first bitterness was past, overdrawn and exaggerated. They had been written in moments when her hurt and angry soul demanded some outlet for its emotion and barbed her pen with venom. Emily was mistress of a subtly malicious style when she chose to be. After she had written them, the hurt had ceased and she thought no more about them. But they remained, the letters. And one spring day, Aunt Elizabeth house cleaning in the garret while Emily played happily with Teddy at the tansy patch, found the bundle of letters on the sofa shelf, sat down and read them all. Elizabeth Murray would never have read any writing belonging to a grown person, but it never occurred to her that there was anything dishonourable in reading the letters wherein Emily, lonely and sometimes misunderstood, had poured out her heart to the father she had loved and been loved by so passionately and understandingly. Aunt Elizabeth thought she had a right to know everything that this pensioner on her bounty did, said, or thought. She read the letters, and she found out what Emily thought of her. Of her, Elizabeth Murray, autocrat, unchallenged, to whom no one had ever dared to say anything uncomplimentary. Such an experience is no pleasanter at 60 than at 16. As Elizabeth Murray folded up the last letter, her hands trembled with anger, and something underneath it that was not anger. Emily, your Aunt Elizabeth wants to see you in the parlour, said Aunt Laura when Emily returned from the tansy patch, driven home by the thin grey rain that had begun to drift over the greening fields. So this is spring. Her tone, her sorrowful look, warned Emily that mischief was in the wind. Emily had no idea what mischief. She could not recall anything she had done recently. Sacrilege, that's right. I was trying to remember what the title of this chapter was. Anything she had done recently that should bring her up before the tribunal Aunt Elizabeth occasionally held in the parlour. It must be serious when it was in the parlour. For reasons best known to herself, Aunt Elizabeth held super serious interviews like this in the parlour. Possibly it was because she felt obscurely that the photographs of the Murrays on the walls gave her a backing she needed when dealing with this hop out of kin. Not in character. For the same reason, Emily detested a trial in the parlour. She always felt on such occasions like a very small mouse surrounded by a circle of grim cats. Emily skipped across the big hall, pausing, in spite of her alarm, to glance at the charming red world through the crimson glass on the front door, then pushed open the parlour door. The room was dim, for only one of the slat blinds was partially raised. Aunt Elizabeth was sitting bolt upright in Grandfather Murray's black horsehair chair. Emily looked at her stern, angry face first, and then at her lap. Emily understood. The first thing she did was to retrieve her precious letters. With the quickness of light, she sprang to Aunt Elizabeth, snatched up the bundle, and retreated to the door. There she faced Aunt Elizabeth, her face blazing with indignation and outrage. Sacrilege had been committed. The most sacred shrine of her soul had been profaned. "How dare you," she said, "how dare you touch my private papers, Aunt Elizabeth?" Aunt Elizabeth had not expected this. She had looked for confusion, dismay, shame, fear, for anything but this righteous indignation, as if she, forsooth, were the guilty one. She rose. "Give me those letters, Emily." "No, I will not," said Emily, white with anger, as she clasped her hands round the bundle. "They are mine and father's, not yours. You had no right to touch them. I will never forgive you." This was turning the tables with a vengeance. Aunt Elizabeth was so dumbfounded that she hardly knew what to say or do. Worst of all, a most unpleasant doubt of her own conduct suddenly assailed her. Driven home, perhaps, by the intensity and earnestness of Emily's accusation, for the first time in her life it occurred to Elizabeth Murray to wonder if she had done rightly. For the first time in her life, she felt ashamed. And the shame made her furious. It was intolerable that she should be made to feel ashamed. For the moment, they faced each other, not as aunt and niece, not as child and adult, but as two human beings, each with hatred for the other in her heart. Elizabeth Murray, tall and austere and thin-lipped. Emily Starr, white of face, her eyes pools of black flame, her trembling arms hugging her letters. "So this is your gratitude," said Aunt Elizabeth. "You were a penniless orphan. I took you to my home. I have given you shelter and food and education and kindness, and this is my thanks." As yet, Emily's tempest of anger and resentment prevented her from feeling the sting of this. "You did not want to take me," she said. "You made me draw lots, and you took me because the lot fell to you. You knew some of you had to take me because you were the proud Murrays and couldn't let a relation go to an orphan asylum. Aunt Laura loves me now, but you don't. So why should I love you? Ungrateful, thankless child." "I'm not thankless. I've tried to be good. I've tried to obey you and please you. I do all the chores I can to help pay for my keep. And you had no business to read my letters to father." "They are disgraceful letters and must be destroyed," said Aunt Elizabeth. "No," Emily clasped them tighter. "I'd sooner burn myself. You shall not have them, Aunt Elizabeth." She felt her brows drawing together. She felt the Murray look on her face. She knew she was conquering. Elizabeth Murray turned paler, if that were possible. There were times when she could give the Murray look herself. It was not that which dismayed her. It was the uncanny something which seemed to peer out behind the Murray look that always broke her will. She trembled, faltered, yielded. "Keep your letters," she said bitterly, "and scorn the old woman who opened her home to you." She went out of the parlour. Emily was left mistress of the field, and all at once her victory turned to dust and ashes in her mouth. She went up to her own room, hid her letters in the cupboard over the mantel, and then crept up on her bed, huddling down in a little heap, with her face buried in her pillow. She was still sore with a sense of outrage, but underneath another pain was beginning to ache terribly. Something in her was hurt because she had hurt Aunt Elizabeth, for she felt that Aunt Elizabeth, under all her anger, was hurt. This surprised Emily. She would have expected Aunt Elizabeth to be angry, of course, but she would never have supposed it would affect her in any other way. Yet she had seen something in Aunt Elizabeth's eyes when she had flung that last stinging sentence at her, something that spoke of bitter hurt. "Oh, oh," gasped Emily. She began to cry chokingly into her pillow. She was so wretched that she could not get out of herself and watch her own suffering with a sort of enjoyment in its drama, set her mind to analyse her feelings, which is what she usually did. And when Emily was as wretched as that, she was very wretched indeed and wholly comfortless. Aunt Elizabeth would not keep her at New Moon after a poisonous quarrel like this. She would send her away, of course. Emily believed this. Nothing was too horrible to believe just then. How could she live away from dear New Moon? "And I may have to live 80 years, Emily groaned. But worse even than this was the remembrance of that look in Aunt Elizabeth's eyes. Her own sense of outrage and sacrilege ebbed away under the remembrance. She thought of all the things she had written her father about Aunt Elizabeth. Sharp, bitter things, some of them just, some of them unjust. She began to feel that she should not have written them. It was true enough that Aunt Elizabeth had not loved her, had not wanted to take her to New Moon, but she had taken her, and though it had been done in duty, not in love, the flat fact remained. It was no use for her to tell herself that it wasn't as if the letters were written to anyone living, to be seen and read by others. While she was under Aunt Elizabeth's roof, while she owed the food she ate and the clothes she wore to Aunt Elizabeth, she should not say, even to her father, harsh things of her. A star should not have done it. Her father's daughter. "I must go and ask Aunt Elizabeth to forgive me," thought Emily at last, all the passion gone out of her, and only regret and repentance left. "I suppose she never will. She'll hate me always now, but I must go." She turned herself about, and then the door opened, and Aunt Elizabeth entered. She came across the room and stood at the side of the bed, looking down at the grieved little face on the pillow, a face that, in the dim, rainy twilight, with its tear stains and black shadowed eyes, looked strangely mature and chiselled. Elizabeth Murray was still austere and cold. Her voice sounded stern, but she said an amazing thing. "Emily, I had no right to read your letters. I admit I was wrong. Will you forgive me?" Oh, the word was almost a cry. Aunt Elizabeth had at last discerned the way to conquer Emily. The latter lifted herself up, flung her arms about Aunt Elizabeth, and said chokingly, "Oh, Aunt Elizabeth, I'm sorry. I'm sorry, I shouldn't have written those things, but I wrote them when I was vexed, and I didn't mean them all. Truly, I didn't mean the worst of them. Oh, you'll believe that, won't you, Aunt Elizabeth? I'd like to believe it, Emily. An odd quiver passed through the tall, rigid form. I don't like to think you hate me, my sister's child, little Juliet's child. I don't. Oh, I don't, sobbed Emily. And I'll love you, Aunt Elizabeth, if you'll let me, if you want me to. I didn't think you cared, dear Aunt Elizabeth. Emily gave Aunt Elizabeth a fierce hug and a passionate kiss on the white, fine wrinkled cheek. Aunt Elizabeth kissed her gravely on the brow in return, and then said, as if closing the door on the whole incident, "You'd better wash your face and come down to supper." But there was yet something to be cleared up. "Aunt Elizabeth," whispered Emily, "I can't burn those letters, you know. They belong to Father. But I'll tell you what I will do. I'll go over them all and put a star by anything I said about you, and then I'll add an explanatory footnote saying that I was mistaken." Emily spent her spare time for several days putting in her explanatory footnotes, and then her conscience had rest. But when she again tried to write a letter to her father, she found that it no longer meant anything to her. The sense of reality, nearness, of close communion had gone. Perhaps she had been outgrowing it gradually, as childhood began to merge into girlhood. Perhaps the bitter scene with Aunt Elizabeth had only shaken into dust something out of which the spirit had already departed. But whatever the explanation, it was not possible to write such letters anymore. She missed them terribly, but she could not go back to them. A certain door of life was shut behind her and could not be reopened. And that's the end of our chapter and today's reading. Wow. All the feels. Goodness me. Wow. We have a new understanding, kind of, between Emily and Great Aunt Elizabeth. We will see how that goes. We've only got two chapters left of the book, so I'm hoping that they will never be best buddies. They're not those sort of personalities. But I think there is going to be a greater understanding between the two of them. What do you think? Hey? So the next chapter is When the Curtain Lifted, and then the last chapter is Emily's Great Moment. Oh! That was an intense one. It's not usually quite that intense. Oh my goodness. Look forward to reading it. I'm thinking, since we've only got one or two more days of reading, just thinking aloud, thinking ahead, I'm thinking that we'll probably read one of the William books by Richmore Crompton. Just because this has been it's been lovely. I've really enjoyed reading it. But I think it's time for, after we finish this one, something that's a little bit more lighthearted and amusing, a little bit more humour to it, which we will have if we read one of the William books. So I'm looking forward to that as well. I have been thoroughly enjoying reading through Emily of New Moon. I've read it several times when I was growing up and in my late teens, early 20s. It's been one of my favourites over the years. I didn't enjoy the second and the third books as much, probably because it's more adult thinking, adult life, adult things that you've got to work through. And I liked the way the first book caught hold of the way Emily perceived the world, her imagination, and how she was growing in that, rather than the day-to-dayness of becoming an adult, which are in the later books. But that's just me. And I'm hoping that if you really have been enjoying this book, that you will actually go on and read the other two books for yourself. They're Emily Climbs and Emily's Quest. They really are. They're lovely stories. They're just not ones that fit the ethos of what I'm wanting to do here with this channel, with my reading here. It's fairly narrow, the field that I read. It is, you know, school, preschool age through to early teens that the target stories were originally written for. Not that everyone who listens has to be in that age bracket. Obviously, some of my favourite books are written for people much, much, much younger than me, and they always have been, those sort of books. I think there's so many other books that are available to be read that a lot of the time the old children's books have been forgotten and overlooked. And so I really enjoy sharing them with you, helping people to experience something, a world that no longer exists, a way of seeing the world that no longer exists, and just stretching our imaginations. It's wonderful. Anyway, so there we go. It's now after 4:30, so that was a nice long read for today for me. The cough's over, that's good. And I look forward to seeing you again next time. Thank you for being here with me. Thank you for enjoying the reading, enjoying the story with me. I look forward to seeing you next time. And in the meantime, happy reading. Whatever you read for yourself in your own spare time, whether it's listening to an audiobook or actually reading the words off a page yourself, doesn't matter. Enjoy your reading. Happy reading. Bye.